On most Sundays, I usually try to preach mostly on the appointed gospel. But on this, the third Sunday of Lent, I would like to say some words about the tremendous revelation contained in today's Old Testament reading from the book of Exodus. In the Old Testament, someone's name was something much more than an artificial tag to distinguish one person from another person. In the comprehension of the Hebrew language, a name shared a mysterious identity with its bearer. A name could be held in some ways as the representative of the person himself. Someone's name was thought of almost as a substitute for the man or the woman. The spoken name could be thought to act as a living person. A name could express the distinctive essence of a person. The name connected visible with invisible realities. In the case of someone in authority, a name could justify their exercise of power. Invariably, Hebrew names, rather like Native American names, meant something. The name Adam, for example, meant father of us all, as Eve meant mother of us all. Abraham meant the father is exalted. Isaac meant he laughs. Jacob meant the heel ground. Even the name of Jesus, which is actually a shortened form of the name Joshua, very specifically means God saves. And when it comes to the various names used for Almighty God, all the significance, all the power connected to any name is raised with reference to the divine reality and raised to a truly infinite degree. This explains the reluctance of God in the Hebrew Scriptures, and even the reluctance of angels or demons throughout the Bible to reveal their true names, because knowing their name indicated a kind of participation in the power and the being of the person thus designated. In the Old Testament, there is also a tendency to understand all the various names used for God almost as buffers or intermediaries between our limited human understanding and the unlimited, endless reality of the Supreme Being. It was also understood that our human perceptions, our delusions, all our lies, our blindness, our cruelties, invariably limit our perception of the one true living God. In today's reading from the book of Exodus, we hear about the awesome revelation of the true name of Almighty God. Moses is tending the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. From a distance, he sees the fire of God blazing out of a burning bush that is not consumed. God calls out to him from the burning bush. Moses, Moses, God calls him. Come no nearer. Remove your sandals, for the place where you stand is holy ground. God then identifies himself. I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. Moses hid his face because he was afraid to look upon the face of God. But from out of the burning bush, God called Moses to lead Israel out of slavery in Egypt and into the promised land. But Moses asks, when I go to the Israelites and say that the God of their ancestors has sent me to lead you into freedom, and they ask me, what is God's name? What am I to tell them? And from the burning bush, God replies in an awesome self-revelation. This is what you shall tell Israel. I am sent me to you. Yahweh is my name forever. Yahweh meaning I am who am. I am who is with you. I am who is for you. I am the creator, the one who brings into being whatever is in being. This is my name forever. Thus am I to be remembered through all generations. According to the Hebrew scriptures, Yahweh is the explicit name of God. This is the personal name of the one true God revealed to Israel. This name for God indicates that to God alone belongs unlimited, unconditional being. There are no other gods. Only God is God. And God's name was considered to be so holy, so full of power, so full of meaning, that even today, no believing Jew would dare pronounce the holy name. At the time of the Second Temple, and during the lifetime of Jesus, only the high priest, only once a year, only on the Day of Atonement, only in the Holy of Holies, with great fear and trembling, only then would the high priest pronounce God's holy name. On all other occasions, when the explicit name appeared in the Law and the Prophets, in the Psalms or the Writings, the name Adonai, or Lord, would automatically be substituted. That is why even today, among both Jews and Christians, the name of God is treated with the utmost reverence. That is why it is a sin to take the name of the Lord in vain. Throughout the New Testament, the Lord Jesus Christ is insistently described as the Son of God, as the Word incarnate, the incarnation of the one true God. Jesus and the Father are one. The God of Israel, revealed to Moses on Mount Horeb, is the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. As Jesus himself teaches, before Abraham came to be, I am. In Jesus, the personal reality of God is now fully revealed in the person of Christ. As the letter to the Hebrews explains, in many and various ways God spoke to us through the prophets, but now in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. Jesus manifests God to us in a visible, tangible form. After the resurrection, the Apostle Thomas acknowledges Jesus with those titles which belong to the Father when Thomas cried out, "My Lord and my God." The earliest textual evidence of Christianity's faith in the full divinity of Christ can be found in the Christian prayer, Maranatha, meaning, come our Lord. This invocation, found both in St. Paul and in the book of Revelation, is preserved not in New Testament Greek, but in Aramaic, the language spoken by Jesus and by the very earliest communities of Christians living in Jerusalem or in Judea. This formula of prayer obviously predates the Greek-speaking churches founded later by various apostles or by St. Paul. This invocation of faith literally means, come Adonai in Aramaic and Hebrew, come Kyrios in Greek, or come our Lord in today's English. Remember, Adonai is the name substituted for Yahweh, the most sacred personal name of the God of Israel. So when we pray Kyrie eleison, begging the Lord to have mercy, as when we begin our worship of God at the beginning of the Mass, we are invoking Jesus as our Lord and our God, possessing all the steadfast love and constant mercy of the one true God revealed to Israel, or as Jesus later revealed, with words of surpassing consolation for those who would follow him, God is my Father and your Father, my God and your God. As Lent continues, I would urge all those preparing for baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist, and all of us cradle Catholics, all of us ready to renew our faith, to pay close attention to all the powerful readings from the Old Testament which the Church gives us to savor during our Lenten liturgies. When we worship God and offer him our praise and thanks in the Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, let us remember great Moses as he trembled in awe before the presence of God in the burning bush. As we prepare for new life in baptism or renew our baptismal promises, let us remember the people of God as they pass safely through the sea and escape from slavery. As we reflect upon our confirmation in the Holy Spirit, let us remember the blazing fire in the cloud of God's presence that entirely enveloped the holy mountain of Revelation. As we prepare for Holy Communion, let us remember how God fed his people with manna in the desert, that bread that came down from heaven. And as we invoke the name of Almighty God, both in the liturgy and in our lives, let us all remember that he alone is God, that his holy name is sacred beyond compare, and that we owe him our worship and our obedience. And in this cathedral, in our families, in our hearts, in our souls, let us always remember that Jesus is Lord, the only begotten Son of the Father, consubstantial with the Father, who will come again in glory. So as the Church has prayed from the earliest days of its existence, both in the liturgy and in anticipation of the end of time, Maranatha, come Adonai, come Kyrios, come our Lord. For it is through him, with him, and in him be glory, honor, and power to the Father and to the life-giving Spirit, now, always, and forever. Amen.